So today, guys, we're going to do archaeological levels in our workshop, and we're using one of the more simple bits of survey equipment in archaeology, which is a dumpy level. Personally, I can see pros and cons on lots of different survey devices. We've talked about this in other videos, and we're talking about planning and survey. One advantage of the dumpy level, or the biggest advantage in my mind, is that the data tends to be committed to paper. And if we're digging 800 or 900, 3,000, 10,000-year-old archaeological sites, we want to make sure that whatever data we capture is around for a very, very, very long time. Obviously, the likes of total stations and GPSs have infinite survey advantages over dumpy levels, but where they fall down sometimes is that it creates digital data which isn't always kept available or kept accessible for future generations. So let's start with the basics. Let's start with the dumpy level. Three bits of equipment. I'll just go and grab them now. Under normal circumstances, folks, we'd do this outside, but it's blowing a gale outside, so we're very fortunate to have an indoor teaching centre here at the Carrick Centre, where we teach students indeed in weather like this or in rain when they come to the live field school. So we're going to set up inside. It might seem unusual, but that's what we're doing today. Three bits of equipment, as I said: tripod, staff, and level head in the box, okay? The tripod is like any tripod you'll use for photography or anything else. It's very simple, it doesn't need much explanation. Frequently a band holding the three legs together. If there is, take it off. Simply unclip your legs. And set up your tripod, okay? When you're happy with it, obviously clip your legs off. Now, obviously, I've set this up inside just for demonstration purposes. If we are outside or on a real archaeological site, the first thing you need to think of is, where do I want to put my tripod, okay? The tripod should be positioned somewhere where it's secure, okay? But also where there's good visibility to take whatever levels you need to take. So there's no point setting the tripod up in a location where you can see half the archaeological site, but maybe half the view is being obstructed by a spoil heap or by a tree or by equipment, a building, whatever it might be, okay? The tripod also always needs to be above the features you're trying to take, okay? So you can't set it up at this level if there's a large bank that you need to get a level on. It always needs to be at the highest point, okay? So you set it up, you get it level, you then make sure the legs are secure. So if I was on grass now, I would probably be digging these legs in, okay? And you also position it in such a way that there's a space where you're in the direction you're going to be taking most of your levels. Basically, what I'm trying to say is you don't want to be trying to take your levels leaning over a leg, because obviously you might knock it, okay? Make it inaccurate, and then you have to start from scratch again. So once you're happy with your tripod, you'll see some professional surveyors will take out a little spirit level and they'll put it on the top. In reality, it's fine, certainly in an archaeological context, to just level that base plate, what we call the base plate, which is here, to level that visually, okay? So we'll, I can see that's a little bit off level. Okay. Now, you might wonder why I've set that up so low. You can see I'm not the tallest individual in the world, but it's certainly a good bit below my eye line. I always say to the students, archaeology is about good teamwork as much as anything else. And of course, I can crouch down when I'm taking a level, but I can't jump. Well, I can, but not very accurately. So you always want to consider who is the shortest person on site is going to be taking levels to make sure the whole team can use it, all right? When you're happy with your tripod, you move to your second bit of equipment, which is the level head. Now, when this has been put back in the box from the previous use, the feet, and by feet I mean these little feet here, they should have been reduced so that the level is fully extended down, okay? And indeed it has been on this occasion. So you get your level, once you're sure the feet have been put into their bottom position, and you clamp it in with the clip on the bottom. Okay. Now, once that is done, you move 2 feet at a time to get the level perfectly level, the level head perfectly level. There's a little spirit bubble here, just like on a spirit level, and you keep moving your feet until the bubble comes into the center of a circular target, and you know that your level head is perfectly level, okay? Like anything, sometimes you get lucky with this, sometimes it takes more time, but just keep going until you get it perfectly level. It's always better to use 2 feet together, simply because if you use one at a time, the bubble tends to spin around the outside and not come into the center at all, okay? So I'd say on this occasion we might be unlucky when we're lucky outside, so I might be getting it to cut. Nope, broke out, almost level. Now, when you get it level, and it's level now, sometimes the instruments can lie to you a little bit, okay? So I always give it a 360 turn and make sure it comes back to level again. And it has. So the instrument is probably actually a tiny bit off, so I'll give it one more go. 360. Okay, and we're level. Just to explain the various different pieces on the head, okay? So this large knob on my right-hand side is for focus, okay? These smaller two knobs, it'll be imperceptible to the camera, but it's basically moving the level head in either direction, left or right. So obviously you can move it with your hands, but if you want more refined movement, that'll move it to either side. As I said, the spirit bubble is here with a little mirror above it. The feet are here for adjusting, getting your level head level in the first place. Then at the back is my eyesight that I look through, and at the top is what I would call the gun sight, okay? So it's exactly the same as a gun sight, but it allows you to position and to find different things roughly, and then you look through your eyepiece and use your focus, okay? What you will be looking for is obviously the staff, okay? So this is our staff here. Again, very simple bit of equipment, so it can extend up to a maximum of 5 meters in height. So there's various different increments on it. You'll see the first increments are meters. There's a second meter coming up now, okay? Then the second set of increments are 10 centimeters, 0.2 to 0.3 in this instance. Then there are 5 centimeter increments, which are the solid boxes as distinct from the unsolid boxes. And then there are centimeter increments, which are each of these little individual boxes. What that means in reality is this instrument is only accurate to sort of a maximum of about 5 millimeter. So for instance, if I was taking a reading, looking through this at the staff and at it here, that's 0.30. This will be 0.31. This will be 0.32. But you'd be estimating whether it's the top, the middle, or the bottom of a box. So for instance, 0.305 would be the middle of this box here, okay? And we will have graphics coming into the video at various different points to make this clear, all right? When you're using the staff, you extend it up. Two things, always make sure it clicks in properly. So you can see there's a bit of movement there because that hasn't clicked in as well as it should. There you go. Okay, that movement may have brought an accuracy into the levels. And the second thing, just especially on CRM or commercial sites, make sure the base plate is intact. Because if you're holding it over a datum point, especially if it's something slender like a nail or a surveyor's pin of some description, it can slot up into the staff and bring in a couple of centimeters in accuracy into your levels, okay? Once you're happy that your staff is correct, you go and hold it in the point you want to hold it to. And this is where so taking levels requires two people. One person to read the levels, one person to hold the staff, okay? This requires a certain level of communication between the two. So if I am holding the staff here, for argument's sake, sorry, I'll put it back into shot, and somebody is reading the levels from further over on the site, they'll give simple instructions of this way or this way if I'm holding the staff in a slant either direction. So obviously I'm holding the level slanted this way, I'd expect to get a direction to bring it back. The same with backwards or forwards. So you'll see with other survey devices, total stations, GPSs, etc., the staffs may have a level on them. With the dumpy level, because it's only accurate to about 5 mil, they just want the staff to be held visually straight. You don't have to get it level with any sort of a bubble, and whoever's taking the levels should give you those instructions. If you see a strange set of hand signals like that, it means the staff is not high enough. So simply extend it up to the next height, okay? So that is the staff. So at this point, I'm gonna ask Chris to come in and we're gonna take a couple of fictional levels just to give you an idea of how this works and what way it's done, okay? So the first one we are going to take is, we're going to imagine there's a post hole just here. Can you hold that please, Chris? I'll go over, you see again, I'm not hitting the legs in any way as I go to take this level. I sight it with my gun sight. I see that Chris has a crooked, so Chris, that way. The reason, of course, if you're this close, you can just talk. The reason why we do the hand signals, indeed the reason why we're inside today in this great facility, is you can't always hear people in wind or rain, all right? So the hand signals can come in handy. Okay. So, just get a pencil. The region I'm getting is right here, okay? In the middle of this box here, okay? And just to count up again, this is 1.31, 1.32, 1.33, 1.34, 1.35. So as I said, these big boxes are in 5 centimeter increments. So this reading, because it's in the middle of the box, will be 1.355, okay? All taking that level has taught me at this point is that the fictional post hole on the ground here is 1.355 meters below the level of the level head. So obviously this level head is shooting out at a straight plane, straight line of sight coming out, hitting the staff here. So I know that the level head is exactly 1.355 meters above the post hole, okay? If you're on a site here, you would obviously take a note of that in either a levels book, a notebook, the site journal, the drawing sheet, depending on the exact conventions being put in by your site director. So I'll put in 1.355 there, okay? That's called a foresight. Okay, so on an archaeological site, you might only have one or two foresights. You could have hundreds, you could have thousands of them, because you're taking levels on anything that you think is important, where there's a change of slope, where there's a wall, where there's a post, where there's a pit, where there's a break in slope at the base of a ditch, etc., etc. Okay, so you could have literally hundreds of foresights, but of course they're absolutely useless without being able to reduce them to meters above sea level. So that's the next, I suppose, section we're going to talk about, all right? Just before I get to that, I want to show one quick graphic to camera, which will make things easier for the students. Obviously, you can't look through the level head. Normally, we'd have queues of students here looking through, but this is an online program. So when you look through the level head, this is what you will see, okay? And you'll notice what we call hairlines. So a vertical hairline coming here, and a cross hair coming across the middle, and you'll see a small little top hair and a small little bottom hair. You always, always, always only take the middle hair, all right? The top hair and bottom hair were used years ago, going back 10, 15 years plus, to calculate distance. You could technically calculate the distance the staff is away from the level head. It was a survey that we used to use years ago, predominantly before total station, the GPSs were even in common usage. So always take what we call the middle hair. And again, you'll get a good idea of that is 1.425, you can see, just as it is there, okay? But we were 1.355. So I've just taken a note of that. So now we have to reduce that to meters above sea level. And to do that, we use a known point on site that in Ireland and the British Isles and a lot of Europe that we would call either a benchmark or a temporary benchmark. So a benchmark, the clue's in the title, it's a permanent point on site that you know the meters above sea level on. A temporary benchmark is a point you brought in temporarily to a construction site, an archaeological site, etc., to serve the same purpose. The acronym or the initials for that are TBM, okay? In Australia, and particularly in America, you would call it a datum. So if you've heard that expression before, they're one and the same thing. Because we use this site for training, we have actually transferred a datum from the known points out in the archaeological site in here. So we do actually have a datum in the site. I'm just gonna go out of shot, sorry, Alan, if you can span with me. We have dropped a little pin into the ground right here. So there's a little pin dropped into the floor surface just here. And that was done with a GPS. And this is TBM2, which is on our notice board here. And it's 27.32 meters above sea level. So we know exactly what the height above sea level of this point is, okay? When you are putting a datum or when you are putting a temporary benchmark, whatever you want to call it, onto a site, you, in real context, not in a teaching context like here, you always want to put it somewhere where it's not going to be disturbed, especially for the duration that you're going to need it. So there's no point putting it where people are walking, where there's heavy traffic, where a digger is going to be digging, where it's likely to be moved or interfered with in any way. On our real archaeological site just outside, we've actually drilled and put it into the concrete footpath into the site. So we know it's there for perpetuity, or at least for the duration of the archaeological dig. And indeed, we still get it checked every year to make sure it hasn't budged at all, okay? So the point we have here is 27.32. That's our datum, okay? Now we're going to figure out how to use that to get a real value on our fictional posthole over here. So again, Chris, I might just ask you to hold the staff on this reading here. Okay, just right on the peg, on the top of the peg, that's great, yep. And that's why you want your base plate intact, guys, because the nail can't slot into the level staff and make it inaccurate. So I would, at this point, go back and read off my level head and see exactly what the level is, okay? We did that previously, just to speed it up. This is like a cooking demonstration, one we've done earlier. And it's like we set it up at it's exactly 1.4 meters. So 1.400, a very handy even number on this occasion, okay? What that tells us is the level as it's set up today is 1.4 meters above this peg. And we know that peg is at 27.32 meters. So 27.32 plus 1.4 is 28.72 meters. So our level as it's set up today is at 28.72 meters, okay? That is called our instrument height, our IH, okay? So our instrument height changes in every given day. You have to calculate it every day. And indeed, it's the first thing you should do whenever you're taking levels. I know I took my foresight first in this video for demonstrative purposes, but imagine if I came out to the archaeological site and took 600 levels, and then someone thought I was finished with the level and took it down, or worse still, just simply knocked into it and it fell over. All those levels would be lost because I didn't know what height the instrument was at. So you always calibrate or calculate your instrument height first. So we know our instrument height today is 28.72 meters. All we would have to do then to calculate our height of the posthole is to subtract the foresight, that original measurement we got, which was 1.335, was it?
Yeah.
We subtract 1.335 off this instrument height, 28.72. And then we know the reduced level. So we know the height of that feature in meters above sea level, okay? According to our national grid.
And you do that every time then, Dennis? Every time that you move the dumpy level?
Yep.
And you reset it up, that's the first thing
you do. So when we go out on site, if it's raining, the level has to come in sometimes, it goes back out, you set it up, you calculate your instrument height straight away. Sometimes you bring it in on tea breaks, if you're worried that it might get kicked or damaged, you bring it out and you recalculate it straight away. So it's a slow and laborious way of getting levels. But as I said, my favorite thing is that all these levels are written down. I'm gonna go and get one to show Alan, I may as well. All these levels are written down on physical sheets of paper, like this. So you'll be seeing these in lots of our other videos, guys, if you haven't already watched them in a video. All the levels will be listed off, okay, along the side, and then the reduced values will be listed off along the side. So we are not contingent. Paper lasts a long time, especially handwritten paper, hundreds of years. We are not contingent on some version of AutoCAD or total station software, or GPS software being updated. We know we have it. And indeed, these are for field school. Again, this is going slightly outside the limits of this video, but there's prompts. What's your temporary benchmark? What's your backsite? It's told you to get them, all right? So we do give the students prompts, all right? So that's how to take meters above sea level. As I said, our levels, as we call them. On an archaeological site, with lots of features, you could be taking them on all sorts of different things. In the context of burial, as a very minimum, you want to make sure to get one on the top and bottom of the cut. And if it's an articulated extended burial, also on the feet, on the sacrum or pelvis, and on the skull. That's what the bioarchaeologist will want as a minimum. And as you'll get, I hope, a clear impression, obviously watch all these videos, the archaeologists work in tandem with the bioarchaeologists. So we capture important information in the field. They obviously get very, very important information in the lab, but it's when you merge the two together, these two different narratives, that you get the full story of that person, of that individual. So first workshop we're recording today anyway, archaeological levels, guys. We'll move on to something new now. Thanks very much.